So now we move on to the most awaited part of today's conference. So that is the paper presentations. So for this, I would like to introduce Dr. Hemant Bhargav, Assistant Professor, Yoga, Department of Integrative Medicine, NIMHANS, to moderate this session.
Over Thank to you. Thank you very much, Dr. Umesh. I welcome the judges for the oral presentation now. Professor Rima Dada, who is a professor in the Department of at AIIMS New Delhi, is with us. Dr. Monojit Debnath, the professor in the Department of Genetics at NIMHANS, is with us. And Dr. Naveen Vishweshwaraya, who is the president of Enigma, Indian Naturopathy and Yoga Association, is also with us. So with your permission, sirs, should we start the oral presentations now?
Please do.
Okay, so I request the first presentation slides to be shared, please. So today, the first presenter is Mr. S. Arthu Chodane. He is from Vedu Medical College and Hospital. The title of his presentation is Effect of Yoga Therapy on Neuromuscular Function and Reduction of Autism Severity in Children with Autism Spectrum Disorder. So Mr. Arthu Chodane is with us. We will share your slides and then your time will start. So once again, briefly, I will repeat the rules of this oral presentation. The time given will be 6 minutes. And after 6 minutes, I will say that 1 minute is left, because in the last presentation, we had this query that the presenters were not able to hear the bell. So we are not playing any bell now. I from here will just say that 1 minute is left, and then at sixth minute, and then the presentation should finish by seventh minute. So the time management also is important, because judges will be judging you based on that also. Fine. Good evening. Let us start the presentation.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. Good evening, chairpersons. Present, my study is on yoga therapy can improve neuromuscular function in children with autism spectrum disorder. It's a pilot study. I'm thanking to co-investigator Dr. Meena Ramanathan, Dr. Anand Bhavanam, Balayogi Bhavanani, and Dr. Parthiban and Dr. Rashmi Jatia, madam. Next, sir. Next, sir.
Next slide, please.
Yeah, next, sir. Yes, of course. Now, autism is characterized by the dysfunction in sensory perception and motor function that are linked to neuromuscular function in the children with autism spectrum disorder. This is what we found the background of the study. And to the aim of the study is to find the effectiveness of yoga therapy on muscular neuromuscular function and autism rate in children with the autism spectrum disorder. Next, please, sir. So the methodology we adapted here, the randomized controlled study, and the study was done in the school, Satya Special School, located in Pondicherry itself. And the inclusion criteria, the participants were included based on this inclusion criteria, this CAR scale, childhood autism rating scale, between 15 and 33.5, because we don't want to take the severe condition, because since it's a pilot study, we're taking the mild and moderate conditions only. And the average of the age of the children is between 6 and 18. Those who are able to perform yoga techniques, able to do, we are just included. And along with that, parental and school informed consent also obtained. So excluded criteria, the major physical abnormalities as well as those who are not willing to participate yoga techniques or yoga performance. So after obtaining the informed consent from the parents and school authority, the trained clinicians selected 40 children aged between 6 and 18, between the scores 15 and 33.5, using the scores childhood autism rating scale. The subjects were divided in further two groups, that's a 20 each yoga and control group. Next, please, sir. So the study design means yoga protocol design. It starts with the Om chanting, because this children were special children. They were not able to do all the sounds, and some are able to do some long and some under. In the beginning, we just prepare them. And for that, after that, the loosening practices, just handshaking, trunk twisting like this. Excuse me. Tada Kriya, Tadasana, and Vrikshasana. Those were, of course, they were not able to do in the first class itself, but slowly, slowly, they were able to do in the sixth or seventh session itself. And the Pavana Muktasana, even in the Sarvangasana, they are unable to raise the legs in the beginning of the sessions. Slowly, slowly, they are gradually, they're getting that strength to bring up. This we found in the pilot study. And the variables we used for in this study, hand grip strength and visual reaction time is a quantitative, and the autism rate by car scales. Next, please, sir. The results we found in this study, visual reaction time shown significant when compared to the control, and the car scale just in the significant line is not much, but in the line of significant, and hand grip strength also is some students are more like 2 kg differences per second, like whereas some students are not like that. We found border level changes. The significant improvement in independent control group means group comparisons, visual reaction time and car scales are much we found. So the test we used, because the normality test is failed, the data was not passed the normality test. So we used the Wilcoxon ranks test and then Mann-Whitney U test for the inter and intra-group comparisons. Next, please, sir. Visual reaction time, the significantly shortened. This research similar to that the another study found by the Bhavanani, that was asana and pranayama reduces the reaction time by enhancing the central processing ability with the effect of the alertness, sensitiveness and sense of perceptions like this. The delta median score of hand grip strength also showed improvement in the yoga group. This also endorsed the increased attention span, like as we have seen in the earlier study, Narsingh Rao and Sekuria and Sokalingam et al. There is a core scale also shown a positive change in the yoga group compared to the control group. It's attributed mildly that mood enhancement was there. They have shown good positive, like smiling, positive changes. So in these 10 sessions of yoga therapy, so authors have suggested that this improvement can influence the mechanism of sensory motor, frontal, striatal, and developmental alteration of the brainstem, which showed positive changes in the involving cognitive, motor, and behavioral functions within the brain of the children with autism spectrum disorders. Next, please, sir.
Last 1 minute.
Yes. Yes, madam. So in this study, we found that 10 supervised yoga therapy sessions showed mild changes in the core scales and a significant improvement in the visual reaction time and hand grip strength in children with autism spectrum disorder. This indicates that the specific issues and long-term can be used for the specific issues and long-term treatment method to improve core scale in children with autism spectrum, and also improve the reducing the comorbidities of autism. Yes. Next, please, ma'am. Yes. Any questions, sir?
I request the judges to ask questions.
What do you think is the reason behind a decrease in the visual reaction time?
Visual reaction time, I just selected because that hand grip strength, the stimuli, it doesn't responsive. If we are talking, means they are not responding, they are not understanding. So we just had a visual reaction time to see the responses, sensory responses, how the things are changing, getting change in the children's.
Okay. What
yeah.
do you think? I just want to know, this is not related to your presentation, but why in the recent decades has autism increased so much? What do you think is the cause for increase in autism?
Madam, in autism, maximum the sensory and motor, sensory dysfunction and motor coordinations are disturbed. So we just coordinated the neuromuscular function.
No. Madam is asking why the incidence has increased in recent times. The recent GBD study in 2017 has shown India stands first in in its ranking, in the world ranking, with respect to incidence. So why the incidence has increased? That's what Madam is asking.
What do you think that there is such a steep increase in the incidence of autism?
And after that, they are able, slowly, they are able to do. This is another perception we found. And the things like Tadasana, yeah, Vrikshasana, they are...
I just want to know that why has the incidence of autism increased in the recent decades?
Oh, in the recent decades?
Why?
It is a birth means born developmental, neurodevelopmental disorder, we say, like stress. It is out of stress of parents. So there is a slogan in Tamil, Thirumandiram. So in that it is mentioned that the stress of the parents giving birth means at the time of intercourse, they are in more stress, the formation also will be disturbed like that.
No.
It is mentioned in the
Thirumandiram
text.
No. This is not even top
so
five theory of...
maximum the stress of the means parents.
Okay. So, Madam, yes, please.
Yes, Manojit, you ask, please.
Okay. So this is a heterogeneous group.
Yes, sir.
Okay. When you are considering children from 6 to 18 years, so this is a truly heterogeneous group. So whatever outcomes you are getting, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
Those outcomes will be biased. Okay. So the performance of yoga at 6 years and performance of yoga at 18 years will be, there will be a huge difference. So how you'll do the quality control check on this, the performance of yoga, number one. Number two, you're talking about neuromuscular function, right?
Yes.
How valid is that marker to check the neuromuscular function? So if you're talking about visual and hand grip, right? So the
yes.
hand grip pattern, there will be huge variation between 6 to 18 years old. Okay. So
yes.
how do you take care of all these things?
Here we categorize as a mild and moderate stage of the autism children based on the core scale.
I got it. Okay, I am talking about age. Okay.
Yes,
I am not talking about the severity.
Okay, sir. So age, because we are not getting the sufficient number of subjects, the subjects are available in this age. So we included from the 16 to between 16 and 18. If we are getting in the short range, like 6 and 12 or 12 and 18, in the sense means we are able to do, because the number of subjects also we means lot.
No, number of subject is one thing, but what matters a lot is the scientific rationale.
Yes,
okay.
Yes,
so that is different issue. Number is different issue.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
The scientific rationale should matter.
Yes, sir. in this case, availability of the subject, we just had that. That's why we have selected that between age 6 and 8.
No, no. Do you think that hand grief will be same in 6 years old child and 18 years old adolescent?
Definitely, there is a difference. That's why we found that there is a mild changes also there, but which we cannot measure in the dynamic of means analog hand grip dynamometer. We are supposed to purchase that digital one, and of course we purchased that. Age wise is there is difference, and the other thing is the sensory means the sensation, the feeling. They have the cognitive that they need to grip means then only. Otherwise, they don't grip. That's another point, sir.
So you say that is a cognitive marker. Then what is the best marker for neuromuscular assessment?
More in the age-wise, the age segregation also does matter, sir.
Okay.
Okay, much of it is
yes sir.
Asked only one question from my side. Did you have any specific difficulty in teaching yoga to these people, these children?
Yes sir, sure sir, definitely. Before
the
that
learn in itself,
yes sir,
I would have liked you to address that, because much of the papers of autism spectrum and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder studies,
yes,
so far,
yes,
do discuss the difficulty in teaching these people. So there is a requirement to develop teaching methodology of yoga to these kind of population.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Do you have a quick answer to that? I know it can be a very long answer, but do you have any quick answer in pointing out any specific difficulty, and if you've done anything innovatively to solve it?
Yes, sir. In this pilot study, we found there is we need of the segregating that group based on the ADHD, like inattention group. If we segregated, means there will not be any trouble while teaching the students of something like external stimuli, like crying.
I interrupt you.
Yes, sir?
I understand you might have taken some of those steps that can be discussed much later, but did you want to bring to all of us who are here live with you any particular difficulty that you did find despite doing all of those steps?
Particular difficulty in the sense when we use after interaction all these things, there are some children used to cry because he don't want willing to participate, he don't wish to do that. In that case, that the disturbance is like a crying, so it is there, sir.
Fine, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam.
Thank you. We move on to the next presenter. The next presenter is Dr. Nivedita Sudhir. Dr. Nivedita is from NIMHANS, and the title of her study is The Effect of Yoga on Electroconvulsive Therapy Induced Cognitive Deficits, a Randomized Controlled Trial. Over to Dr. Nivedita.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Okay. So I'll be presenting the findings of our study. Thank you. So I'll be presenting the findings of our study titled The Effect of Yoga on ECT-Induced Neurocognitive Deficits. And this was a pilot RCT. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Could you please change to the next slide? Right. So this is a brief review of pertinent literature in this field. You've skipped a slide, the previous slide. Yeah. Okay, right. So ECT is a neuromodulatory technique that is well established as a treatment strategy for psychiatric disorders. However, an important limitation in the use of ECT is the associated neurocognitive deficits. Post-ECT neurocognitive deficits involve multiple cognitive domains, which include memory as well as non-memory domains. Among them, prominent are verbal memory, which is assessed by the Ray Audio Auditory Verbal Learning Test, and executive function, more specifically phonemic fluency or verbal fluency, which is associated, assessed by the COVA test. Over the years, various treatment strategies to mitigate neurocognitive deficits have been explored. However, the results have remained largely inconclusive. And thus, mitigation of neurocognitive deficits associated with ECT remains an unmet need. On the other hand, yoga has emerged as an important tool in our armamentarium, both in terms of treatment for mental illness, as well as in improving cognition. Neurobiological studies have suggested that yoga can both increase BDNF levels and reduce cortisol. And these have been shown to be beneficial. In our review of literature, we found no studies evaluating the role of yoga in mitigation of neurocognitive deficits. And thus, this study was planned to fill this gap. Next slide, please. The aim of our study was to assess the effect of concurrent yoga with ECT on different cognitive domains affected by ECT. And the hypothesis was that concurrent practice of yoga will be associated with fewer cognitive side effects as tested on the RAVLT and the COVAT. Next slide, please. Yeah. The methodology, the patients posted for ECT in a 10-month period between January and November 2019 were approached. These patients had primary psychiatric diagnosis, which included schizophrenia, bipolar affective disorder, as well as depression. They were referred for ECT by the primary treating psychiatrist. The study was sanctioned by the Internal Ethics Committee of the Institute, and the CTRI registration was obtained. Written informed consent was also obtained before inclusion. Exclusion criteria included those with history of substance disorder, comorbid neurological disorders, including epilepsy or intellectual disability, and those who had received ECT in the prior 3 months. Among those screened, 38 were found to be eligible and consented for participation in the study. And they were randomized by a block randomization with concealment and allocation concealment to two groups, which was the yoga group and the control group. I was the assessor and I remained blinded till the end of the analysis. The scales administered included Ray auditory verbal learning test for verbal memory, controlled oral word association test for phonemic fluency, the NBAC for working memory. Both the COVA as well as the NBAC are tests of executive function, the autobiographical memory scale, and the visual memory scale. We also rated illness severity on the BPRS, which is the brief psychiatric rating scale. Assessments were done at 3 time points: baseline, which was before or after the first ECT, after the third ECT, and then after the sixth ECT. The yoga arm received daily yoga sessions, which was a validated module for validated for MCI. It includes asana practice, pranayama, and om chanting. This was done by a yoga instructor and modified for comorbidity. The duration of these sessions was about 1 hour, and these were done throughout the course of ECT. The other group did not have any intervention. Can we move to the next slide? Now coming to the analysis. So we approached around 73 patients who were screened. 38 of them were recruited. 18 were recruited to the yoga arm and 20 to the control arm. Prior to the baseline assessment, 6 patients dropped out, all of whom were in the yoga arm. So subsequently, we had 12 patients in the yoga arm and 20 in the control arm. Again, between the baseline and the third ECT, which was the next follow-up, we had another 7 dropouts, 4 in the control arm, 3 in the yoga arm. And again, between the second and the third follow-up, we had another 5 dropouts. So finally, we had about 20 out of the 38 participants who actually completed the trial, of whom there were 7 in the yoga arm and 13 in the control arm. So an intention to treat analysis using the last observation carry forward was used for the for imputation of missing data. Considering the small size and the normal non-normal distribution of the data, non-parametric tests were used for analysis. The results revealed that both groups were comparable at baseline across various socio-demographic domains. Mean number of yoga sessions attended was about 6.8. The Friedman test for comparing the change in COVAT scores across various time points revealed a statistically significant fall in the COVAT score for the control group. the Wilcoxon ranks test with Bonferroni correction also showed us that the COVA scores in the control group fell significantly between the first and the third follow-up. So can we move to the next slide? The survival analysis, as you can see in the plot, also revealed the proportion of fall in the COVA was higher in the control versus the yoga arm. We also compared BPRS but found no significant differences between the groups. Next slide, please. Thus, to conclude, this was a pilot RCT. It was an exploratory study, and the results suggest that yoga may have a protective effect on certain neurocognitive functions in patients receiving ECT. We propose for studies with larger sample size with adequate power to detect differences in the other cognitive domains, which we perhaps may have missed. The study also demonstrates the feasibility and utility of yoga in an acutely ill psychiatric population. Thank you. The following slides contain my references.
Yes, sir.
Could you tell me what are the neurocognitive deficits which follow ECT?
Ma'am, typically in literature, the deficits which have been described include tests of deficits in autobiographical memory. They also include other domains such as verbal memory, verbal fluency, working memory, and visual memory as well.
Okay, and how long after ECT is stopped do these persist?
Ma'am,
how long does yoga have an effect? Sorry? How long do these effects last after ECT, and how long you discontinue yoga after the ECT is given? So how long does the effect of yoga last?
Ma'am, so in literature, what we found was that usually a lot of studies have reported that these deficits do last for up to at least 2 weeks, starting from ECT, the day of ECT onwards. And a lot of patients show recovery. However, the recovery is incomplete, and continued recovery may even be seen at up to 6 months. So the exact duration is still up for debate. As for about how many days we would have to continue yoga to see a benefit, one of the limitations of our study is that we did not continue yoga beyond the course of ECT to actually see that. And since there is no other literature and this is an exploratory study, I wouldn't be very sure. But perhaps one limitation which other studies could work on is perhaps do follow-ups at 2 weeks after stopping ECT and subsequently at 3 and 6 months with continued yoga to see if there is any difference between the groups.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Two quick comments rather as opposed to questions. Is this a first ever attempt to explore yoga for managing the deficits post ECT?
Yes, sir. We couldn't come across any other studies on the same lines.
Okay. And I would have liked to, I don't know whether you've done this. There is a study comparing Sudarshana Kriya Yoga to ECT. And those patients or that particular group which received SKY, did they not have these known deficits that otherwise ECT, like if they have a similar effect of ECT, and that itself is a strong preamble for you to use yoga, and if that being preamble, have you considered similar techniques here in your protocol, or is it completely different from SKY or related breathing pattern that is used in SKY?
So again, to answer that question, I'm not very sure of this study because I haven't actually, I don't remember going through this. However, I can...
paper because this was almost pitched against ECT and pharmacological therapy, and the SKY was comparable in its outcomes. So wherever the ECT is indicated, potentially with more studies, SKY could be a possible recommendation prescription. But anyway, that's something that you can look at because this is your pilot study. The second thing is, as a pilot study, I've been seeing quite a few of these studies. When you do randomized control trial, longer follow-ups, which is much needed in yoga because most of them are very short-term intervention studies. So I'm happy to see 3, 6, 9 month follow-up. But as a short presentation of a portion of a study or a pilot study, for you young researchers, it's important to look at methodology as opposed to results, because you know that's going to change as you add numbers and all of that. So I would have liked to see a strong confirmation of how you did randomization, how did you develop meet the requirement of consort and trial profile, analysis of dropouts. You know, those are the methodological details that make a study robust and strong. Which is why a large number of Indian studies do not stand the test of meta-analysis. You know, we don't take care of these simple things. We need to spend more and more time in our planning and making our studies stronger. We have the advantage of numbers in our country, given any study on yoga, be it physiological or patients. And we have the advantage of using classical yoga, where we can say it's a first-hand yoga intervention available, because we have a wide spectrum of people available to offer the intervention. But these two advantages will only be useful if our study designs are very strong. And you, all of you should focus on that, so that eventually when you had a good number of studies, I know it's an interim presentation, if it's a randomized control trial, it's going to go on. Make those strong and tell us that, and also share with the fellow colleagues, junior and senior alike, so that we'll start to see these strong studies, methodologically very strong studies. I just would want to say, take this overarching comment and go back and work on all of that. Yeah.
Sure. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Nivedita, yes. For this pilot study, why did you consider 3 groups? I mean, your group is very heterogeneous. You have skis, you have bipolar, you have MDD. Right, and finally you will end up with only 20. So for a pilot study, you could have considered only 1 group, right? It would have made one homogeneous group. And I think now you have too many things to take care. The yoga module is different for MDD, for schizophrenia, for bipolar. So
to answer your question, that is one of the main limitations of our study, the fact that we have a very heterogeneous sample. The reason being mainly because the study was a part of my MD thesis. And given that the duration of the study itself was quite short, we had a period of about 9 months for recruitment. We were not sure we would be able to get adequate numbers if we went with only one diagnosis. So either say depression or schizophrenia, which is why we went with a heterogeneous sample. Further, if we had the numbers, the plan was to analyze each of the subgroups separately, but unfortunately, our numbers were too small for that.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now we move on to the next presenter. Our next presenter is Mr. Suman Bista. The title of his presentation is Yoga-Based Lifestyle Intervention for Type 2 Diabetes, a Prospective Single-Blind Randomized Controlled Pilot Study with 6 months follow-up. Over to Mr. Suman.
Hello. Yes?
Yes, we can hear you. Please start.
Okay, so I'm Mr. Suman Bista, and my topic is Yoga-Based Lifestyle Intervention for Type 2 Diabetes, a Prospective Single-Blind Randomized Controlled Pilot Study with 6 months follow-up. Next slide, please. So diabetes is increasing every day. It is a global problem, especially for India. And 90% of the patients with diabetes are the type 2 diabetes. So 33 articles have been already published seeing the effects of yoga on diabetes, but only 3 RCTs saw the long-term effects. Those also could be improved by the allocation concealment and single blinding. So this study is aimed to robust the design also. And then again, prevalence of depression is very high, 38% in Indian diabetic population. It is just one meta-analysis concluded. And depression is very strongly associated with diabetes, and they have the bi-directional relationship. They are the risk factor for each other. So this no RCT has been seen the long-term effect of yoga on the depression on the diabetes. So present study aims to see the effects of yoga on long-term study. This screen is in my little now. Okay. So to assess to the impact of 6 months yoga life intervention in biochemical anthropometric variables and the psychological variables, and to see the correlation between type 2 DM or the glucose levels with other psychological variables. Next slide, please. So subjects type 2 DM participants, HbA1c more than 6.5 according to American Diabetes Association, and this sample size is 90, 45 in control group and 45 in exercise group. Source of subjects, employees, their relatives and nearby residents of tertiary healthcare center, Bangalore. Design two group pre-post randomized control prospective study, and randomization with allocation concealment was done, and assessment person will be was blind, single blinded. So ethical consideration, we have taken the ethical clearance and CTI registration was done. And income concern has been taken from the every participant. It is the DST self funded project. And you can see the demographic data. There was not any significant difference between participants between two groups. Next slide, please. So inclusion criteria, type 2 DM participant with 10 years of diagnosis, age ranging from 40 to 70 years. Exclusion criteria, type 2 DM participant with severe psychiatric and physical condition and severe complications. Yoga group, there was the validated yoga module developed by AYUSH Ministry, and 1 hour per day, 5 days per week for 6 months we have given for this module. Then first 1 month there was the supervised session, and after that they practiced at the home by the help of videos provided by us. And yogic lifestyle education was given for 1 month every week for 45 minutes. Exercise group followed the same protocol, but they did exercise at the place of yoga, and they got the health education. So assessment HbA1c, APS, and PPBS has done, and anthropometric assessment was done, and PHQ-9 for depression, DAS-42 for depression, anxiety, and stress we have done. Then the peaceful sleep quality for the sleep. Then data analysis we have done followed by the this intention to treat analysis, LOCF method. Then RM and MWAP for the between group and within group comparisons. Then Pearson correlation coefficient for the correlations. Then we can see, we can use SPS version 24. We screen 409 people, and then we eventually recruited and randomized 19, 25 yoga and 25 control group. Then 14 in yoga and 11 control drop out of the study, and 31 and 34 remind. So you can see the yoga intervention, including asana, pranayama, meditation, and control intervention too. Next slide, please. So results show that 41% of participants had depression, mild to moderate. Then medication scores of subjects did not change significantly as compared to baseline. Then mean HbA1c reduced almost 0.54% in yoga group, but only 3.5% in control group. There was significant time interaction effect of HbA1c levels favoring yoga group. Then post hoc analysis revealed that there was significant reduction in HbA1c levels in yoga group, but not in control group. There was significant group time interaction effect for depression scores in both PHQ-9 and DAS scale. Then stress and anxiety reduced in both groups with no significant between group differences. And there was strong positive correlation between depression and the HbA1c levels, and positive correlations with stress with the HbA1c levels. There was significant group time interaction effect of sleep quality favoring yoga group. Then Western hip circumference changed in yoga group, not in control group. Next slide, please. So you can see in the pictures, there is a strong correlation between the HbA1c level and depression, both in PHQ-9 and DAS-42 depression, and moderate correlation between HbA1c and stress level. You can see that HbA1c reduced very significantly in yoga group only, not in control group. FPS reduced in both groups as compared to HbA1c, it is flexible, and PHQ-9 only reduced in the yoga group. Next slide, please. Then again, you can see that depression.
One minute left.
Then anxiety, waist and hip circumference, and PSQI scores reduced in yoga group only. Next slide, please. So as the previous study, we also found the yoga is effective for the HbA1c levels and hip and waist circumference and the depression. We found 41% of the prevalence of the depression in diabetes and associated depression and stress level. Strength of the study is reverse methodology, long-term intervention, and validated assessment tools. Limitation is small sample size. And the conclusion is that yoga-based lifestyle intervention serve as the useful add-on in the comparison to aerobic exercise in HbA1c and other risk factors and variables. Future studies should focus on the long-term follow-up. Next slide, please. This is my reference. Thank you very much.
What is the advantage of yoga over aerobic exercise? You had active controls, isn't it?
Yes, madam.
So what is the advantage of yoga over exercise?
Yes, madam. So yoga has some more components than exercise, than like awareness, breathing, and relaxation. So that one is that whenever we give passive control group have the placebo effect also, they can feel that we're not doing anything and we're not improving also one thing. Then another thing is that when you go for the active control, then there will be the scientific way to prove that yoga is better than exercise if there is. So those physical activities, we want to see the actual this components of the yoga, like relaxation, awareness, breathing.
No, but how does relaxation and awareness affect type 2 diabetes with depression? Type 2 diabetes, and in yoga, you would not lose energy. I mean, you would, like in exercise, physical exercise, you spend energy, so you tend to lose more weight. But in yoga, you would regulate basically the emotional eating pattern. So do you think yoga is more beneficial or aerobic exercise is more beneficial?
Yes, madam. Study also demonstrated that yoga is more beneficial. Current study also showed the same. So
why?
Yoga also had some physical activities, but those will be controlled by the control group, active control group. But still, there may be some hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis which control the some stress responses, maybe the sympathetic parasympathetic balance, or whatever this concept may work there. But for the mental way also, it demonstrated that it is slightly more effective. Here we could not find the so much big differences between the groups, but we could see the slightly more effective than the exercise.
No, I'm asking you, why is yoga more effective?
So that is my answer is that same. Yoga has the components, more components, breathing, awareness, and relaxation. And these components will affect to balance the sympathetic nervous system, parasympathetic system on the brain also. And maybe it will relax. And when relaxing the mind, then the central nervous system also works properly. And again, breathing, while breathing also, we can regulate our autonomic functioning, because breathing connects the autonomic and voluntary both. So there, okay. That may be the reason.
Okay. Yes. Thank you.
This PPT, you just close this PPT, please, because I am little difficult to seeing this skin because of this PPT.
Two questions. One, Are you continuing this study or are you stopping it here?
We are starting another, we are planning to start another study.
Okay, no, no, that's not, I don't want about other study. Just answer this question. Is this a transplant study or completed recruiting patients?
It's completed study.
Why would you do such a small study in an area where there are so many studies demonstrating effectiveness of yoga?
Yeah, yeah.
Number one. And it's a good thing that you're looking at long-term follow-up. You have to have a larger sample. Otherwise, this is of no use. This is number one. Number two, are you modules? What do you say that you used as intervention? What is that?
Sir, please mute, sir. Sir, please mute, sir. Please on the mic, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, sir, one in short user, sir.
There's a problem in Japan.
There. I saw one of your slides saying that yoga intervention is called Ayush module.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Ayush. Where did you get it? What is it?
Where it was published, sir?
No, no, no. There are yoga protocols available for diabetes of all categories. Correct. So many studies. And the intervention that you used in this study, you refer it to as Ayush, an intervention called referred to as Ayush model or module. What is it? Where is it from? Who devised it?
Yes, sir. It is from the Ayush Ministry of India. Then it is developed by this committee of the Ayush Ministry. And
I am not aware of any such recommended protocol.
So it is already validated in a Pan India trial, sir. It is, I have given reference also there.
I'm formally aware that there is a recommended protocol for research studies. So I want you to know that. And in case if it is, you have to put a reference in your reference list when you cite a pre-developed protocol, right? So that is second. The third thing is, I just saw your graph, which is showing. Can you tell me absolute reduction in your HbA1c from 0 to 6 months? What was it 6 months and what is it? What is it 0 and what is it 6 months?
This one is 0, sir.
One slide behind, I think. Yeah. Is it 8.1 and 8.6?
It 0.4.
Mean difference of HbA1c. Now you don't report this. I mean, at the end of 6 months, if you report, 8.6 has become 8.1. I mean, that's not encouraging at all. Right? So if that is your HbA1c, then I would not consider these findings any significance. The only takeaway message, I think, which you should pursue if you close this study, that I like it, maybe you should do a cohort survey or evaluation of simply looking at glycemic control and stress and depression correlation. I think that's the only takeaway from your study, which I think you should build on. Otherwise, I think there's a lot of methodological issues here. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Suman Bisden. There are many studies on the impact of yoga on depression in diabetes patients, right? First of all, what is the novelty of this study? That is the number one question. Second question is that you have shown some correlations between HbA1c and depression. What is the implication of this finding?
So novelty of this study are the only three studies have seen the long-term effect, and here the design, we just allocation consultant was not done. Then again, blinding was not there. At least one blinding is possible in yoga research. So we developed this. Then this in Ayush model has the input of different schools of yoga and recommended by the Ayush Ministry also. So it is just we are improving the design and seeing the long-term impact of the this module. This is the new thing. And we are, and depression and anxiety, and in this depression, psychological factors also, something that yoga can cure depression also and HbA1c.
No, that is clear. That is clear. That is evident from earlier studies also, right? So what is the implication of this correlation, biochemical parameters with depression, like HbA1c?
These correlations actually already also was there. Now in baseline data we compared, we basically the primary, our purpose and the objective is to see the effect of long-term yoga and HbA1c level and depression, the reduction, how much effect will be there. So it is the secondary analysis we have done. This correlation.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, judges. Now we go to the next presentation. Dr. Prerna Bhargav, impact of yoga on resting state functional connectivity in major depressive disorder.
Yeah, good evening all. Am I audible and visible?
Yes.
Shall I start? So I'm Dr. Prerna Bhargav, working as Junior Scientific Officer in the Department of Integrative Medicine, NIMHANS. Today I'm presenting on impact of yoga on resting state functional connectivity in major depressive disorder. So major depressive disorder is an, next slide, is an ubiquitous psychiatric disorder characterized by pervasive depressive mood, guilt, disinterest, worthlessness, hopelessness, and even suicidal tendency in worst scenario, leading to devastating social, personal, and medical consequences. Various studies have shown alteration in multiple functional brain networks, including default mode network, frontal parietal network, and salience network, as well as localized neuronal inefficiency at medial prefrontal cortex. Okay. Yoga has shown to improve symptoms of MDD, but the impact of same has not been examined on resting state fMRI measures. So this study was planned as a prospective randomized control trial. It is a part of a larger trial which aimed at assessing the impact of 12 weeks of yoga given as an add-on to standard antidepressant treatment on resting state functional connectivity, with the hypothesis that it will influence the altered functional network connectivity, including MPFC. Next slide, please. Next slide. So, Institute Ethics Committee approved the protocol, and patients with MDD having moderate to severe depression were recruited from IPOP settings at NIMHANS. 37 subjects who met the inclusion criteria of falling in the age range of 18 to 16 years and scoring a minimum of 18 on Hamilton Depression Rating Scale or more than that were recruited after taking written informed consent. And structural and resting state fMRI images were obtained for them at baseline along with the clinical assessment. And then they were randomized to either yoga therapy group or weightless group using block randomization. So 16 subjects were in yoga therapy group who received standard antidepressant treatment along with 1 hour of yoga module validated for depression at NIMHANS. 12 sessions were given in the first 4 weeks, followed by 2 booster sessions in the next 8 weeks, and then home-based yoga practice. Weightless group subjects were given standard antidepressant care and were offered yoga therapy at the end of 12 weeks. And then at the end of 12 weeks, all the parameters were assessed again. Medication at baseline was comparable amongst the two groups with no change during the course of treatment. Next slide, please. So data acquisition was done using 3 Tesla MRI scanner, and these were the EPI parameters for structural and resting state MRI. Analysis was done using connectivity toolbox CON18B to analyze resting state functional connectivity using C2 region of interest method. And statistical analysis was done using SPSS-16. These were the steps followed for analyzing the imaging data. I'm not going to do the detail. Next slide, please. So in results, we found that both the yoga therapy and weightless group showed significant clinical improvement over time in RM ANOVA, with more improvement in yoga therapy group. In fMRI measures, we found yoga therapy group showed significantly increased connectivity between DMN, default mode network, and salience network. Salience network with language network, and salience network with paracingulate gyrus. Also, sensory motor network showed increased connectivity with frontal medial cortex, and increased connectivity between frontoparietal network with cerebellum. Yoga therapy group also showed decreased connectivity between sensory motor network with salience network, rostral prefrontal cortex with the middle temporal gyrus and anterior supramarginal gyrus. Within weightless group, increased connectivity was found between dorsal attention network and lingual gyrus, left and right hemisphere. Next slide, please. So as that those results were within group and we didn't find any significant between group results in CON, so we extracted the pre-post connectivity scores and we further analyzed them using RM-ANOVA, and we showed significantly increased connectivity over time between DMN and salience network seed. Further analysis showed that improvement was more in yoga group. Also, there was increased connectivity between salience network and superior temporal gyrus, salience network with the paracingulate gyrus, and sensory motor network with language network. Significant time group interaction was found for salience network between salience network and language network favoring yoga therapy. And significant time group interaction was found for dorsal attention network with lingual gyrus left and right hemisphere favoring weightless group. Next slide, please. So coming to the discussion part, previous studies have shown on MDD that there is hypoconnectivity between neural system involved in processing emotion or salience and midline cortical regions. We found results that yoga therapy showed increased connectivity between salience network seed and DMN, which is a midline cortical region as well, and also our a priori region. Also, increased connectivity was found between salience network with paracingulate gyrus, again a cortical midline structure. Previous studies have shown hypoconnectivity within attentional and emotional networks. So we found within weightless group, increased connectivity between attentional network. Also, yoga group showed increased connectivity between attention network and salience network, which has shown in previous yoga studies on healthy people, long-term yoga practitioners on resting state functional connectivity. So the results are in line with the previous findings. Coming to the implications.
Last 1 minute.
Last slide, please. So our findings are quite interesting in this study, where we are finding that default mode network has shown increased connectivity with supramarginal gyrus, which has a central role in empathy. So default mode network, that too medial prefrontal cortex, which is responsible for social and emotional interaction of social and emotional conditions happen there, and it regulates mood. So if yoga can influence MPFC, it can influence mood and social functioning, and also can translate in autonomic and behavioral outcome. Another interesting finding in this study is that cerebellum, which was previously known for coordination and timing of body movements, has recently been acknowledged as involved in cognition, especially executive function. And we have found that yoga therapy group showed increased connectivity between frontoparietal network, lateral prefrontal cortex with cerebellum. So coming to the strength and limitation, this is the first systematic study to assess the impact of a series of yoga sessions over 12 weeks on resting state functional connectivity in patients with depression. I commit resting state data because it's still in analysis that would give us a confirmatory direction. Coming to conclusion, I must say MDD is a network-based disorder and various important networks are involved in it, which are related to interoception, attention, memory, cognitive control, and affective processing. Our study uncovered the putative neural effects of yoga therapy in MDD and needs further systematic detailed approach for confirmatory conclusion. Thank you. With this, I end my presentation.
Dr. Naveen, you ask.
Okay. First of all, a very good study of great importance. And while we are looking at qualitative or clinical data, we were concerned about numbers. And for a neuroimaging study, these are very good numbers. That's a very strong number. And if the imaging quality and the processing and the data processing and image processing are strong, and this is a good study. I'm not sure whether you are going to add more subjects to this group.
No, sir, we have ended the project.
I think it's already good. So that's a good point, but there are a few concerns here or clarifications that I would seek to see, would like to see. One, before I talk about the content of what role did you play in this study? It's a large Samatvam funded study. You know, when we report a large study of this kind, particularly highly objective data of neuroimaging, it's important to specify what role a presenter plays, because everybody would be carrying this study in your group, right? The same slide set, more or less.
Yes, sir.
What was the role?
Sir, actually, I worked as research associate in this project, and I was involved with the recruitment process and data acquirement and doing
data?
The follow as data acquiring. So MRI and clinical data scoring, like fixing the follow-ups with the patient. So all that I handled.
Okay.
And also I was involved with the analysis part of this MRI. So as it is an objective measure, so there is no chance of bias because we use the...
So did you learn image processing techniques?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Excellent.
Yes, sir.
So your role is both in terms of patient management, recruitment, yes, and sir. Follow-up, and image processing.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So which is why I can focus my questions to your role rather than study as a whole, right? So now image processing is a very, very complex task. I'm sure they'll be helping you.
Yes, sir. I took the technical help. Let's
go to the question for want of time. There are certain artifact sorting issues, there are large number of studies on yoga and meditation being published using fMRI, but there are issues with artifacts, whether it is movement artifact retroorbital fat giving opaque signals. So there are quite a few artifacts that come in the way in the quality of analysis of images.
Yes.
So do you want to comment anything there?
Was there
any issue, and how did you circumvent that?
Yes, sir. So like when we started the analysis process, we first manually checked each imaging data, and we removed scans with too much of motion artifact or
my question again more specifically, did you use any particular tool to locate your scanning?
During scanning or during analysis, sir?
You would look up during analysis.
Analysis.
The spots where movements were noted while you scan a person. So there are specific tools now available.
So we basically
manual. When you say manual viewing of images, that's not the ideal way. So there are tools to look at movement.
That was done the first step, and then Con Toolbox does that correction. So slice timing correction, which I didn't talk much about because of the time constraint.
Okay. So I'm asking as a question.
Yeah. So that has been done by the default pipeline in the Con Toolbox. So it corrects that automatically. All those.
Okay. Now, yes. When you talk about patients, more so than experienced meditators or yoga practitioners, as in the case of earlier neuroimaging studies, task-based data is very, very important.
Yes, sir.
So
yes.
Now you're presenting baseline data, baseline changes. Those are very generic in nature, which is why they are in line with the previous studies. But there are two large implications, and you can't really, at the end of the day, not metric conclusions, as you rightly say in your slide, without a task data. I think you can even create, because this is valuable data set that you have. Maybe you can look at a subgroup analysis and then look at some initial task data can be acquired and then superimposed to this data and see how the whole thing works. So that's a big disadvantage I see, because it's patient, it's a data on patients. The third thing is, did you see the correlation with duration, frequency of yoga practice to the changes that you saw? Because we are looking at objective changes here.
Sorry, sir, my internet connectivity went off in between. I couldn't hear what you said last time.
Okay. Do you have correlations? Because you have 12-week yoga, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So across 12 weeks, obviously you can categorize them as regulars and irregulars and intermittent, or as many categories that you want, even though they are small subject. Have you done that kind of consistency or compliance of yoga and correlated with the changes that you see?
Sir, right now we haven't done that, but that is in the plan. And we also have actually task-based data, which is in process of analysis, because it takes a lot of time. So
that's very important that data. Because sometimes the group average as opposed to the highly compliant subjects, we have seen that in meditation studies, are very different. So when you look at the increased and decreased network, there could be surprises there. So it's very important to do that segregation and then look at data. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes,
thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I just had one query. Though meditation, asanas and pranayam constitute yoga, I just want to know which part, asanas, pranayam or meditation, which part has a maximum impact on these neural connectivity?
Ma'am, actually this module comprises of asana, pranayama and relaxation. So it had all the components and it is a package which is a validated module for depression done at Nimhans only. So we must say that all the practices combined together and practiced over a period of time has brought the change.
Doctor, just for the benefit of everyone, if I may add, large number of neuroimaging data available today is on meditation. So this would be a part of the minority group of data that is available on yoga as a whole.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Very good study, Prerna. I just have one question. The question is that you have proposed altered functional connectivity correlates with psychopathology. So did you attempt to correlate in your study?
Yes, sir, we tried. Because we are finding results in so many regions, we tried correlating the clinical score with the data. We did not find any significant relation between clinical score and this in both the groups. So I didn't report that.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now, now we move on to the last presentation, and the last oral presentation in Yantra 2020, Ms. Kankan Gulati. And the title of her presentation is Effect of Yoga on Heart Rate Variability in Major Depressive Disorder. Over to Kankan.
A very good evening to all of you. May I please start the presentation? So the title of my presentation is The Effect of Yoga on Heart Rate Variability in Major Depressive Disorder. Next slide, please. Heart rate variability is controlled by the autonomic nervous system and is an index of a healthy heart function. Heart rate variability is a fluctuation in the time interval between adjacent heartbeats. Low heart rate variability is a marker of a disease and indicates altered sympathovagal balance at the sinoatrial level, which is measured using an ECG. There are two ways of measuring heart rate variability. One is the time domain method and second is the frequency domain method. Time domain method measures the changes in heart rate over a period of time, and frequency domain measures how variance is distributed as a function of frequency. Heart rate variability is impaired in depression where there is an increase of sympathetic dominance. Heart rate variability decreases as the depression severity increases. Routine antidepressant treatments might improve the depression symptoms, but they are not able to improve heart rate variability. As we all know, yoga improves heart rate variability in healthy individuals. Also, it helps in decreasing the depression scores in patients suffering from mild to moderate depression. The aim of the present study was to investigate the impact of 12 weeks of yoga as an add-on therapy on heart rate variability in patients with NDD. We hypothesize that 12 weeks of yoga therapy will improve heart rate variability in patients with major depressive disorder. Next slide, please. So this study is basically a part of the larger study, and has been approved by the institution's ethical committee. The module that was used has been validated and developed at NIMHANS. The inclusion criteria was females and males aged between 18 to 60 years, suffering from moderate to severe depression with the absence of hypo and maniac symptoms, and those who were cooperative enough to do yoga and willing to participate were included. Those who had comorbidities like OCD, psychosis, suicidal tendencies, or mental retardation were excluded. Those with bipolar depression, any physical ailments like CAD, fractures were excluded. Anyone with pacemakers, metallic implants, those ladies who were pregnant or lactating, and those people who were already practicing yoga or any other mind-body techniques were also excluded. Next slide, please. So this is a randomized control trial where we screened 793 patients, and we recruited 68 from them. We block randomized the patients into yoga group and weightless group. The yoga group received yoga as an add-on therapy to the routine antidepressant treatment, and the weightless group received the routine antidepressant treatment, but they were given an option to learn the yoga module post data collection. So after 12 weeks, so the yoga group was given 16 yoga sessions, 12 yoga sessions in the first 2 weeks, followed by one yoga session in the third week and the fourth week, followed by one yoga session in the second month and the third month. At the end of the 12 weeks, we were able to collect data for 17 participants in the yoga group and for 23 participants in the weightless group. The results of the study were that both the groups were comparable at baseline on socio-demographic profile and clinical scores. We used linear mixed model analysis, where we saw that HF power showed a trend of improvement in time group interaction, favoring the yoga group as compared to the weightless group. The pre, post, and the post minus pre mean and standard deviation values of the yoga and the weightless group are given in the table. Next slide, please. The magnitude of percentage of change or the increase was more in HF power was more in yoga group as compared to the weightless group. Also, we found a moderate negative correlation between the number of yoga sessions attended by a participant and the heart rate mean. Both the groups showed clinical improvement over time, but it was more so in yoga group as compared to weightless group. Rest, none of the variables showed any significant differences. And, next slide, please. Therefore, we can say that the increase in parasympathetic activity of the nervous system after a long practice of yoga is in line with the previous studies. The imbalance, that was the increase in the sympathetic and the decrease in the parasympathetic activity, that has been associated with the pathophysiology of cardiovascular involvement in depression, may decrease, as we have reported that there is an increase in parasympathetic activity of the nervous system post-yoga intervention. Also, yoga may prove to be a useful add-on therapy, as antidepressant medications might not have HRV-mediated cardioprotective effects. So the strength of the present study was, this is the first study, this is the first randomized controlled trial assessing the effect of long-term yoga therapy on heart rate variability in patients diagnosed with NDD. The limitations of the study are the sample size is a little small because of the high attrition rate, and there was a lack of correlation between heart rate variables and clinical depression scores. So we can conclude that yoga can serve as an effective add-on therapy to restore the sympathovagal balance. Also, we can say that the more the number of yoga sessions the patients attend, the higher the parasympathetic activity. Next slide, please. These are the references. Thank you.
Yeah, Kankan, that's a good study. I just wanted to know, when the people were doing yoga under supervision daily, was the heart rate variability more as compared to when they started doing it just once a week? Did you do that at those time intervals also?
No, ma'am. We did a pre-assessment and then we did a post-assessment after 12 weeks. the 16 supervised sessions were, in the first 2 weeks, we had given 12 supervised sessions, then followed by one supervised session in the third week and the fourth week. And then the second month and the third month also, we gave one supervised session. They were given a booklet and they were also given a DVD where we had recorded the yoga module, and the booklet also had an explanation of all the asanas and the module so that it is easier for them to practice at home.
But do you actually show compliance? Because sometimes people do all the asanas without doing the time when they need to relax or shavasana, and then it really reduces the efficacy of the yoga module that you're following.
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, we had a follow-up where we were doing clinical assessments after 6 weeks, 8 weeks, and then 12 weeks. So when we used to call up, we used to call them for the clinical assessments. We used to always motivate them to do more yoga practice. And we used to also ask them that how many times in a week are they practicing? How many minutes, how much duration are they practicing? So that follow-up we have done. We tried doing it, ma'am, from our side.
What do you think yoga causes parasympathetic dominance?
Yeah, so ma'am, there can be many reasons that the parasympathetic activity increases. The dermal and the subdermal pressure receptors might be stimulated with the yoga therapy. So therefore, there is an increase in the parasympathetic activity. Also, the HRV increases in the LF range. LF is basically denotes the sympathetic as well as the parasympathetic, but more so of the sympathetic activity of the nervous system. So there is an increase in heart rate variability. Also, the hyperpolarization and the inhibitory signals that are generated by the stretch of the lung, neural and the non-neural tissues of the lungs, they can cause a shift towards the parasympathetic activity. There might be another reason that when the vagal nerve is stimulated and it passes on the signals to the brain of the change in the rate of breathing, the depth of breathing, the pattern of breathing, that is given priority and it changes the brain functions also. And also, I went through a paper that was published in 2018 which said that nasal stimulation is a link between the brain, the breathing pattern and the autonomic functions. So it was a systematic review that was done in 2018.
Yes, that's how pranayam is able to bring about.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I think this is part of the large study that you have of a major depressive disorder.
Yes,
and each one of you are looking at different domains, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If it is part of this larger study, why only for HRV there is such a big drop in your yoga group? Your dropout rate is more than 50%.
Yes, sir. Sir,
now as a paper, particularly presenting in a conference of prize, it's very important for you to look at these methodological issues. I keep telling to all of you, if you gloss over those difficulties, then you're not telling us bad points, you know, and that's where the learning comes from. So if you have 50% dropout, you need to discuss the dropout reasons at length. At least a couple of sentences should be there.
Yes, sir.
I don't see it. So maybe very quickly, one line answer, why there is close to 50% dropout in yoga?
Yes, sir. So, sir, dropouts was basically we would try contacting the patients. Some of them did the clinical scoring, but they did not come for the HRV post-data assessment. Many of them. Some of them shifted. Some of them said they will come, they will come, they will. They used to, every time we used to contact them.
What you say is the dropout is from the assessment, from the intervention, because they were continuing the intervention for other data sets. Is that what you're trying to say?
Sir, for the clinical scores, they did, some of them did. But
the summary of that is, if they did participate in some evaluation, presumably they continued the intervention. They were not actually dropped out from the study itself or the intervention itself, right?
Yes, sir.
So
yes.
There is a part of enough explanation, motivation, involvement, which you have to raise to get the patients that are coming to NIMHANS and not coming to one particular data set is the prerogative of the investigating team as opposed to the patients. So that's something that we need to look at. The second observation is, you made a statement in your conclusion, which again contradicts this based on this observation, that the more the frequency or duration of yoga, the better is the outcome. And to that effect, you make a statement. You really can't make out with 50% dropout, right? So I think you need to take out that completely. It become a very paradoxical statement in your conclusion. You can't draw such conclusion with showing 50% drop. Then coming, and there are loads of HRV papers on yoga and on the fact that this is 12-week and on depression makes it good. But I would have liked to see better numbers.
Yes, sir.
Really not significant, the kind of numbers that you have.
Yes.
That said, a question to you. You don't talk much about time domain analysis. So that said, what's the difference between frequency and time domain analysis?
Yeah. So, sir, frequency domain analysis is basically the time domain analysis measures the difference in the heart rate variability over a period of time. And the frequency domain parameters denote both sympathetic and parasympathetic, whereas most of the time domain analysis parameters, that is RMSSD, PNN50, NN50, all of them mostly show parasympathetic activity.
Are there now favoring one over the other?
Sorry, sir?
Are there reports emerging favoring one over the other?
Sir, I will go through it, but most of the papers that I have been through is reporting frequency domain analysis, not time domain.
Actually not. So there are mixed bag. There are equally good number of studies talk about time domain. You need to look at both. You can't leave out completely one and then only report frequency domain. That does not make it complete. Even for clinical purposes, it is a lopsided reporting. So you need to go back and bring in time domain analysis, augment your observation with the that you focusing on frequency domain.
I did not report it because I thought there were no significant differences in the time domain parameters. So that's why I did not report.
That is why it is so important.
Yes. Yes.
So each one is looking at very different aspects of neural control of heart. So
yes. You
need to, the very fact that you have a distinguishing result between two domain analysis is trying to give us a lead there, right? So which is why you need to do both.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Kankan, I have a very basic mechanistic question. Right.
Yes.
So there are attempts to identify biological markers of yoga in depression. Right. So there are studies on neuroimaging parameters. There are studies on inflammatory pathway, HPLC stress pathway. Okay. So in terms of pathophysiological relevance, okay, the changes in heart rate variability, where you will rate it? If I give you like in the scale of 1 to 5, okay. So does it come in a top 5 pathway of MDD? This heart rate variability, or in other words, okay, how do you rate this as a biological marker of to check the impact of yoga?
So because of the cardiovascular involvement that we have seen in MDD patients, I think HRV is also an important measure to because in most of the psychiatric disorders we have seen that there is a sympathetic dominance. And most of the treatments, the antidepressant treatments, are able to decrease the depression. Able to decrease the depression scores, but they are not able to bring the heart rate variability to normal levels. So I think that yes, heart rate variability is also an important factor when we're talking about psychiatric disorders.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
So with this, we come towards the end of the oral presentations. I must say that these presentations were very interesting, and more interesting were the interactions of the judges with the participants. We had 90 abstracts, of which, after removing the names of the participant randomly, a panel of the scientific committee selected these 9 presentations for oral, and the remaining one also shortlisted for the poster. We got 30 for the poster. The oral presentations now are complete, and now it is a time to thank our judges. So first, I would like to request Professor Shivaram Varambally, our head of the department, to kindly felicitate Dr. Naveen KV.
Thank you, Hemant. I'm very happy to thank Dr. Naveen, who has been with us for 2 days now and patiently listened to all the presentations and asked very incisive questions. Of course, Dr. Naveen is the perfect person to be the judge because he has in-depth knowledge of both yoga and research methodology, as you could see from his questions. And I thank him for, you know, making his knowledge available to us, as well as he has been guiding, of course, Nimhans. When we started establishing the Integrative Medicine Center here, he was one of the people we took advice from. So thank you very much, Dr. Naveen, and I'm very happy to present you a memento. And of course, as some of us will know, Dr. Naveen and Dr. Shirley are married. So both of us have been with us today, and we thank both of you, husband and wife. Thank you very much, sir. Namaste.
Thank you once again, Naveen sir. Now I would like to request Dr. Bindu Kuti, who is the officer in charge of the Center for Consciousness Studies at NIMHANS, to kindly felicitate Dr. Reema Dada. Madam, you have to unmute yourself, Bindu madam.
A very good evening and greetings from NIMHANS, Dr. Reema.
Thank you, ma'am.
We are so happy, you know, to invite you, and you have accepted our invitation. And we thank you for so much for your time, valuable time, and also for your contributions, you know, in terms of discussion, suggestions that are very, very educative. I'm sure that students would have learned a lot. And thank you so much. And please accept a token of appreciation this memento. That will come to you soon. Thank you. And next visit, you know, I have so many colleagues in the Department of Physiology. I am from Department of Neurophysiology, NIMHANS. So next time when I come to NIMHANS, I would like to meet you in person.
Sure, and, ma'am, sure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Shivaram. Thank you, Dr. Naveen.
And I would like to congratulate all the judges, Dr. Naveen, Dr. Reema, and Dr. Manojit, for you know, doing this wonderful job. And it is a great challenge, because most of the presentations are really good. So we thank you on behalf of the organizing committee. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you once again, Reema madam. That was Dr. Bindu Kuti. She is also the chair of the scientific committee of this conference. And and now I request Kaviraj sir from the Department of Neurophysiology to kindly felicitate Manojit sir. I think we are not able to connect to Kaviraj sir. Kaviraj sir, are you there? Then I would request Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao to kindly come online, if he is there online. Or I would request Shivaram.
I am there online.
Yes, sir.
We can see you, sir. Yes.
Sorry, it's not optimized like yours. Shivaram has got almost divinely background. Madam, I have listened to some of your comments, and then it's a learning experience for all of us. Of course, your colleague as well as my colleague also. Thank you very much for joining us and sparing your time.
Sir, Manojit sir needs to be felicitated by you, sir.
Yeah, sure. I'll be delighted. So tell me what I should do. Is there any virtual congratulations or virtual shake hands?
Yes, sir. You may do that. We will show a memento there, sir.
Yeah. Sure.
Kindly felicitate Manojit, sir.
Yeah. He is a distinguished colleague, and I think after seniors term is over, senior citizens, and then this one, I think he is going to be the next hope for NIMHANS, like Dr. Shivaram and Dr. Manojit. I think probably they will guide a huge number of students and scholars in the years to come, and then they'll excel. Not only they'll excel in their field of work, but also they will motivate and guide a huge number of next generation doctors, scholars, and scientists of NIMHANS. Congratulations once again, and thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
With this, we come towards the end of the oral presentations.